whistle blowing, I hang my head and cry.
So can we start the show off with your trademark greeting?
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash. How are you?
He's just cool. He's like the definition of rock and roll, I think.
He's just Johnny Cash. What a luxurious position.
I'm an entertainer. I'm a teller of tales. And some of them are pretty dark tales. Because that's the way life is.
Everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all. My empire of dirt.
My name is Bill Welychka, welcoming you to the story of Johnny Cash. Now, the man in black has reserved a very special place in the history of pop music. He was there for the birth of rock and roll and helped change the face of country music with his unwavering outlaw attitude. Now, it's been said the flame of survival burns high in Cash as years of near-fatal calamities have been fiercely fought and overcome. In August of 1994, I had the chance to sit down with legendary Johnny Cash to discuss the first of four albums he has done with Rick Rubin. Now, these series of discs introduced a whole new generation of fans to the Cash legacy. In this interview, we discussed his internal demons, his friendship with Elvis Presley, and a whole lot more. Through Johnny Cash's words and the words of others, we help pay tribute and tell the story of a true original, Johnny Cash.
Hey, Porter, hey, Porter.
The first songs I ever heard when I was 2 or 3 years old were just the singer and the guitar. And I always, that's what I grew up on until, you know, I was a teenager. And then I really got into the bands and all that, and country and pop. I mean, I knew every song on the radio.
Well, I grew up in the country and living on a cotton farm, and there was nothing to look at except the clouds in the sky.
Johnny Cash was born J.R. Cash, February 26, 1932, in Arkansas at the height of the Great Depression. Have you ever told anybody what the R in Johnny R. Cash stood for?
It doesn't stand for anything. My name is John R. Cash. It's just initial. And I didn't even have a John for a name until I was 18. And I was going to join the Air Force, and the papers came back, said, please fill in your complete name. I'd only been called J.R. all my life. My parents could not agree on what they wanted to name me. My mother wanted to name me Ray. My dad wanted to name me John, but since they couldn't agree, they called me JR. Even as a little tiny baby, I was JR. But when I was 18, joining the Air Force, they told me I had to have a name. So when I applied for a birth certificate, there was no record of my birth. I filled in, I put John, but I left just the R like it was. And my name is officially and legally and really John R. Cash.
JR's early years were spent working the family's cotton farm and growing up exposed to the music on the family radio and the live music, courtesy of his mom and their family piano. By age 12, while spending most days working with his family in the cotton fields, he would begin writing songs. After a stint overseas serving in the U.S. Air Force, he would get serious about music, targeting Sam Phillips Fledgling's Sun Records in Memphis. It was Sam that gave him the moniker Johnny Cash. Early hits didn't quite fit the mold of traditional country or the new rock and roll sound being born at the time, but the hits did take hold of the public regardless.
You're gonna cry, 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 and you cry alone.
There's an awful lot of one-hit wonders back then. How did he avoid that, and where were these songs coming from?
I think he just avoided it by being himself. I don't think he consciously tried to avoid it. I think he just wrote songs that were honest and sincere, and he continued that throughout his entire career.
He would release his debut full-length record for Sun in 1957, Johnny Cash with his hot and blue guitar.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds, because you're mine. I walk the line.
Johnny's Sun Records label mates at the time proved to be a who's who of rock's pioneers, including Roy Orbison, Jerry Lee Lewis, Carl Perkins, B.B. King, and of course, Elvis Presley.
That's all right, mama, just any way you do it, that's all right.
Johnny would open for Elvis in the mid to late 50s numerous times around the Southwest.
I worked with Elvis in the first years, you know. I saw the first public appearance. I was there at the first public appearance Elvis ever made in September 1954. He was playing a flatbed of a truck at an opening of a drugstore in a shopping center. And then the next week, I saw him at a club called the Eagle's Nest. But he had a lot of screaming people there, and he was always a fabulous performer. He was one of those charismatic people that you had to watch, you know. And as it turned out, the whole world watched him.
I think probably the most famous photograph in all of rock and roll is the Million Dollar Quartet. You, Elvis, Carl Perkins, and Jerry Lee Lewis. And I understand that when you and Elvis left Sun Records, it was your choice to not pursue a friendship with them.
Well, you know, it had nothing to do with friendship. I always loved Elvis, and I think the feeling was mutual. It's just that we both move into our own separate worlds. But I did see a lot of star watchers turned away from his gate, and some of them were friends of mine that couldn't get in there, that went down and decided they would renew old acquaintances with Elvis, and they couldn't get in the gate. And I wanted to be sure that never was me, so I never bothered him. We corresponded, you know, when I played the Hilton Hotel in Las Vegas. Three different times he was closing and I was coming in, so we swapped letters, and we sent messages back and forth all those years. I never purposely ended a friendship with Elvis. We just didn't work together anymore. He went to the Army. I went on the road. He started doing movies. I was still on the road. Then he kind of, you know, he was so popular and so important in the music business that, and so everybody was trying to get to him, so he closed his own private, comfortable world in around him. And who am I to say what Elvis died from? I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know what he died from. I hope he wasn't very lonely, though, with having had to close his world in around him. I would be. I'd be very lonely.
Johnny's first royalty check for Sun Records in 1955 was for $2.41. 7 months later, as the hits kept coming and his popularity grew, his second royalty check from Sun totaled $6,000. By the time the 60s rolled on, Cash was a bona fide star and, thanks to non-stop hits, a legend in the making. Still to come on the story of Johnny Cash, crossover success.
And I don't think they should be called crossover records. When music is recorded, it's for everybody.
Because you're mine. I walk the line. I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine, I walk the line. I find it very, very easy to be true. I find myself alone when each day's through. Yes, I'll admit that I'm a fool for you. Because you're mine, I walk the line.
Johnny's success at Sun Records proved almost too big for the small label. Like Elvis before him, his contract was sold to a bigger label. After 3 years at Sun, Columbia Records signed Johnny in 1958, releasing his Columbia debut, The Fabulous Johnny Cash, the same year. Immediately, his singles became country and pop hits.
They talk about crossover records, and I don't think they should be called crossover records. When music is recorded, it's for everybody. In 1956, I had one called I Walk the Line that was bigger, as big in the pop charts as it was in the country.
Because you're mine, I walk the line.
It happened again in 1971 with that song, Ring of Fire. Songs like that made the pop charts.
He did bridge the gap between country and rock and roll simply because he always knew, because he was there at the birth of both, that they really were the same thing.
He kind of took the social consciousness from folk music and the gravity and humor from country music and the rebellion out of the rock and roll and taught all us young guys that not only was it all right to tear up all those lines and boundaries, but it was important.
And not only was it country and folk, and it was also rockabilly, it was alternative music. You know, he just really transcended a lot of lines. He was the best at everything he did.
Now, I saw Dwight Yoakam yesterday on Solid Gold, and he got as big a hand as anybody on the show. So he's not locked into any bag either, and I like to see that.
And Dwight Yoakam has a great record on Ring of Fire. It's one of the best things he's ever cut, I think.
Dwight Yoakam has covered Cash songs numerous times, including Cash's 1963 hit Ring of Fire. Dwight has also covered Cash's Understand Your Man and Home of the Blues.
Well, Home of the Blues off of my new album, yeah. That's a Johnny Cash song. He told me, he said, and I wrote that before Heartbreak Hotel came out. People forget that Cash truly was that continuing hillbilly artist. He really wasn't a rockabilly artist like Jerry Lee became or even Carl Perkins. And he never became a rock and roll artist as Elvis did.
Right.
He stayed really right between the cracks.
In perspective of the 70s, country and rock, it didn't matter. He was everywhere.
Yeah, he was. But Johnny had a lot to say, and he lived, I suppose, a pretty hard life, and because he came from that sense of authenticity. There was truth in that, and I think a lot of what the 60s and 70s spoke of was the truth as opposed to the pop video.
Cash's songs have been covered by hundreds. I Walk the Line has been recorded over 100 times by a mix of various eclectic artists, including Live, Glen Campbell, Bob Dylan, Dean Martin, and even Leonard Nimoy. Get Rhythm, a song Cash originally wrote for Elvis in 1955, has been covered by Ry Cooder, Little Richard, Sweethearts of the Rodeo, and over a dozen others.
Well, I sat and I listened to the Shoeshine Boy, and I thought I was gonna jump with joy.
When someone chooses to cover a Cash song, is it because Johnny Cash did it first, or is it because it's just a great song?
The answer to that question is that there's a Johnny Cash style that has his own persona in it, and it's in everything he writes. And I think that's something that artists themselves try to capture, and it's something that they honor as well, and that's why they may choose to cover it.
I wasted my time when I would try. When the lights have lost their glow, gonna cry.
Country star Marty Stewart has many ties to Johnny Cash. Not only is there a long-standing friendship between the two, but Marty played in Cash's band for 6 years up to 1985. He would also record with Cash, marry Johnny's daughter Cindy, and cover Cash songs numerous times.
You asked me about working with Johnny Cash. Every time I heard Johnny Cash play Folsom Prison Blues or I Walk the Line or Big River, I mean, goosebumps the size, you know, the Titanic. They came up on me. I couldn't help it. It was just it's a part of my soul. And to get to be a part of that and witness it from behind, you know, that's a real special time in my life.
Do you look at him as almost like a son?
Still, yeah.
Literally,
yeah.
He was a son-in-law, but there is a father.
Yeah, there's more than a son-in-law relationship between us. It's more like a father-son. Yeah. I think of him as one of my own, really. And also a friend in the business, because sometimes we don't like act like father-son. We get a little strange.
True, you carved a cross in his mandolin?
Yeah, I scratched it on there.
And it was an untouched mandolin with not a mark
untouched,
on there.
It's just mint condition, beautiful. Oh, this was about 80, 81, something like that. He had it hanging around his neck and was playing his guitar. And I walked up and we've been playing tricks on each other. And I walked up and scratched a cross on his mandolin. He pulled it back around, looked at it, his mouth dropped open. He said, "Why'd you do that?" And I said, "I just want you to remember Jesus loves you." And then after that, he had everybody autograph it because I'd already scratched it.
I've seen that mandolin. There's no more wood left on it.
I know it.
The long list of artists that have covered Cash over the years are as lengthy as the long list of Cash's hits. Some of these artists include Bruce Springsteen, Sheryl Crow, U2, the Everly Brothers, Shelby Lynn, Gin Blossoms, Joan Baez, Elvis Costello, Stevie Nicks, and the Grateful Dead. In 1988, even Johnny's daughter Roseanne would have a hit with his 1961 cut, Tennessee Flat Top Box.
By the little dark-haired boy who played the Tennessee Flat Top Box when he would play.
You've recorded a song we have the video for, Tennessee Flat Top Box.
Right.
That's one of your father's old songs.
Yeah, I didn't know that until we were ready to record it. I thought it was public domain.
It was so old, it was like in the recesses of my furthest memories, I thought, well, this song has got to be public domain. And then I found out he wrote it. That was a surprise.
But those people keep a moving, and that's what tortures me.
Still to come on the story of Johnny Cash, the carefully crafted mystique of the Man in Black.
I've never been in prison, except to sing. You didn't ask if I'd been in jail, so I've never been in prison.
Ladies and gentlemen, Johnny Cash!
Thank you. Well, my daddy left home when I was three. Didn't leave very much to my ma and me, except this old guitar and an empty bottle of booze. Now, I don't blame him because he run and hid, but the meanest thing that my daddy ever did was before he left, he went and named me Sue.
By the 60s, Johnny had cultivated his Man in Black persona.
And I got a lot of laughs from lots of folks. Seems I had to fight my whole life through.
What do you think it is about Johnny Cash that's kept him for 35 years so popular?
He works hard at it. He works hard at being Johnny Cash. You know, it's not like he lays around and forgets about who he is. I think he works hard at being him. He takes his craft seriously, and he's a good writer. And I think the thing that keeps him alive more than anything in my head is mystique. You know, he protects his mystique pretty good. You don't ever get too much of him.
I still think that if he walked into a room or into a vicinity, that there would be a certain sense of this man has a very special presence.
There was a definite presence that you could feel coming off Johnny Cash.
The image has got a lot to do with it, all right. You know, the image that they have of you, that they want to see in concert is awfully important, that you have an image. But it didn't, I don't think it did all that much to help, you know. It didn't make a bad record get in the top 10, you know.
Style is great, but if there's no substance with it, what is it worth?
Johnny Cash's eyes are very black, and they're very deep, and there's just a hint that behind them he might be insane. So there's a certain unpredictability and mystique about Johnny Cash.
Well, when people talk about the Cash mystique, what do you think they're zeroing in on?
I think they're zeroing in on, A, the fact that he's always in black. He's the Man in Black. And he's always singing about things that are very honest and very true. He doesn't paint pretty pictures. He sings about, he sings honestly about love, about religion, sometimes about murder, and nobody really wants to say that's kind of an uncomfortable topic.
There are certain people that walk into the room and that change the molecules of the room. And he's definitely one of those people. When he walks in, the energy just kind of swirls around him, not to sound metaphysical, but it is true. He just has a huge, larger-than-life presence. And he, I think, was a chosen person for this world to enjoy.
Well, I know I had it coming. I know I can't be free. But those people keep on moving, and that's what tortures me.
If you take one of the first singles, Folsom Prison Blues, and you hear a line like, I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die.
But I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die.
Just to watch him die in the early 50s. That's way out of control. And you trace that back, and it's not a wop bop a loo bop a wop bamboo. It's just something a lot darker and very, very scary. And today you hear that in Eminem.
All of this controversy circles me, and it seems like the media immediately.
And so again, it transcended the generations, crossed a lot of lines. And taking a big chance.
This much I can tell you about Johnny Cash. He has a God-given charisma.
Johnny's famous recordings in and about prison added to the Cash mystique. In 1968, he would record a live version of his 1955 hit Folsom Prison Blues at the famed California prison. Always outspoken on various issues, he has even campaigned for prison reform.
I'm stuck in Folsom Prison, and time keeps dragging on.
He, within 1 week, could play for religious leaders and play for presidents of the United States and then turn around and play for the most notorious criminals at Folsom Prison in San Quentin. And not every artist can do that, so you're thinking, who is this guy?
I've never been in prison, except to sing. You didn't ask if I'd been in jail, so I've never been in prison.
But that train keeps rolling on down the San Antonio.
One of several issues close to Johnny was Native American rights. His 1964 album, Bitter Tears, was one of music's first records ever dealing with Native issues.
He would just go with what he thought was right, and he was very vocal about that. The song, The Ballad of Ira Hayes, which didn't get a lot of radio play because it dealt with, a subject matter that was uncomfortable, the wrongful treatment of a Native American. Radio wouldn't go to that. So he went straight to radio and said, why aren't you playing this song? Come on, what are you doing here? This is a real story here. Don't try to avoid that.
Well, I'd written a few things like Apache Tears and Old Apache Squaw and Talking Leaves, like about the invention of the Cherokee alphabet. So I was able to put all the things I'd written about Native Americans in this album. And it kind of took on a protest note, protesting the broken treaties and the maltreatment of the Native Americans and the second-class citizenry that's imposed upon them. And so I got caught up in all that, and it became really close to my heart, and it still is.
The Johnny Cash family tree reads like a who's who of country music. His younger brother Tommy has had a country music career, and Roseanne Cash, Johnny's daughter from his first wife, has had a very successful music career, releasing 11 albums.
It's the right time, you know, I feel fine tonight.
Do you remember songs that he played for you when you were very young?
Yeah, lots.
What kind of songs would you grow up with?
I wouldn't listen to country at home. I was listening to The Doors and The Beatles and... and the Rolling Stones and Buffalo Springfield and Cream and Traffic. But I think the country music was going in by osmosis because my parents were listening to it,
yeah.
You know.
Should I conjure up in my mind an image of the man in black standing in the doorway yelling, turn it down?
My mother would yell, turn it down. My daddy, he wouldn't care.
Was he open-minded musically at that time?
Very, and still is.
Johnny Cash would marry his second wife, June Carter, in 1968.
Ladies and gentlemen, June Carter.
She's the daughter of the legendary Maybelle Carter, the driving force of one of the most influential acts ever in country music, the Carter family. Johnny, June, Roseanne, and the Carter family were all part of the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band's 1989 star-studded album dedicated to mother Maybelle Carter, Will the Circle Be Unbroken?
Will the circle be unbroken? By and by, Lord, by and by.
We still had a bunch of our heroes that we had to document. Johnny Cash, we didn't get a chance to get him on the first record. His mother-in-law, Maybelle Carter, was there so that Johnny was sort of the link with the first album. It was through him and his wife, June Carter, and her sisters, Helen and Anita, that we really felt the continuity.
Carlene Carter is June's daughter from her previous marriage with singer Carl Smith. Johnny's stepdaughter, Carlene, is a successful recording artist in her own right, but has also toured as a backup singer with Johnny and June.
I'm gonna join the family circle at the throne.
When he gets on stage at night, I know by the time he gets through talking about Rosie and Roseanne Cash and myself and my brother, John Carter Cash, that it's like, 30 minutes of like explaining about what his kids are doing. So it's very sweet that they always mention all of us.
In the sky,
what was the household like growing up?
Really fun time, because it was the times that I really remember are like in the late 60s when Mom had first married John and he had the Johnny Cash show and it was on television then. And they always had like a really big rock act on every week. And it was like I got to meet Steppenwolf, the Monkees, Eric Clapton when it was Derek and the Dominoes, and Layla was my favorite song and I was having a heart attack. Bob Dylan, Joni Mitchell, Neil Young. And every week they came to the house, whoever the guest was came to the house and sat around and played guitars. And it was like, I mean, those people impressed me at that time because I was, a normal teenager. That was who I was listening to on the radio and who I was impressed by. And then, of course, at the same time, we had Merle Haggard, George Jones and Tammy Wynette coming by. Chris Christopherson was a really good friend and was at our house all the time, almost every week. And they were just our friends. And you know, it was a lot later that I started to appreciate their music a lot more, although I was always in awe of Chris because he was really young and handsome and I was a teenage girl and he wrote these incredible songs, and so I was always in awe of him. I always thought he was great.
Johnny's friendship with Kris Kristofferson goes back to 1970 when he chose to cut a song by the then struggling writer. The move was indicative of Cash's desire to push the limits of the Nashville establishment using outside progressive writers like Kris and Bob Dylan. Kris and Johnny would team up with Waylon Jennings and Willie Nelson for the country supergroup The Highwaymen. The group would release four records between 1985 and 95.
Perhaps I may become a highwayman again, or I may simply be a single drop of rain, but I will remain.
We were all sitting around in the room and they were all singing and they decided, this really shouldn't stop right here. We should do something else. And that's when they did their first Highwayman album.
I've been Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. I've been a goner.
I've been a loner.
And when my mixture was right, hell, I'm a Nashville two guy.
It's a natural evolution, I think, a progression. The longer you live, the longer you play, the longer you write, you should get better. You're supposed to get better. And the fact that we got healthier is what's amazing. All of us are healthier now than we were 20 years ago.
Been waiting for a long time.
Did Kris Kristofferson really land a helicopter on your lawn?
Yep. Mm-hmm. He'd been trying to get these songs to me, so he finally, and I wasn't paying attention. So this was, he was working as a janitor where I was recording.
I'd been his janitor for a year and a half before that over at Columbia Recording Studio, and I'd pitched him every song that I ever wrote. I'd give them to him, and he'd take and throw them in the lake. I found out later.
And they told him that if he bothered me, wrote me songs when I was recording, they'd fine.
For a brief period, I got in the Tennessee National Guard. There was a helicopter unit. And in one of my training flights, I just took this helicopter with my demo of a song I'd written over to John's house and landed there.
He came one Sunday afternoon in a helicopter in my yard.
Actually, I almost landed on his house.
And I thought, you know, anybody that tries that hard deserves a break, so I listened.
John tells me getting out of the helicopter with a beer in one hand and a Bull Durham cigarette in the other, you know.
Yeah, he had beer. He was drinking.
I drank a lot and smoked a lot in those days, but not while I'm flying a helicopter.
And he practically fell out of that helicopter when he landed.
That's not the way I remember it.
I was born one morning, it was drizzling rain. Fighting and trouble are my middle name. Raised in a cane, break by an old mama line. Ain't no high-tone woman make me walk the line. You load 16 tons, and what do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store.
Still to come, with a whole new generation of fans discovering the cool factor in Cash, Johnny experiences a resurgence.
Cool. What does cool mean? It's such a huge word.
I don't know. It's your word. I don't know. Cool.
You've heard it a lot this year, though.
Oh, yeah, I've heard it a lot this year, and I'm complimented.
Well, I got a friend named Whiskey Sam. He was my boonie rat buddy for a year and now. He said, I think my country got a little off track. Took him 25 years to welcome me back.
Johnny Cash would help pave the way for Nashville's outlaw movement in the 70s, a collection of artists refusing to succumb to certain country music parameters. Johnny would often choose to cut outside material by various progressive writers. He would write subject matter deemed controversial, like native issues and human rights. Unlike most country stars, he refused to wear a cowboy hat. And, always a groundbreaker, he would release one of country's first music videos, 1981's The Baron.
I wish I had known you when you were a little younger. Around me you might have learned a thing or two.
The Baron, that was made in 1981. The first thing I had to do is shave my beard off. I had a beard at the time. And Cash comes and says, son, you want to play my son in a video? I said, sure. He says, it's going to be a pool shooting video. I said, all right. We got to this little bar in Lebanon, Tennessee, and all the early morning drunks were mad because here was this video crew in there, and we flushed them from their bar. And Cash, this is the kind of guy Cash is. This is what I love about Cash. when he saw that all the local clientele, all these old drunks were mad because there was these bunch of people from Nashville in there filming a video, he went and talked to the guy that owned the bar and said, I suggest that we let these gentlemen back in so they can take up with their older business and we'll take up with ours. They won't get in our way, we won't get in theirs. That's the great thing about Johnny Cash. He's a mediator, man. He's a great communicator between any walks of life.
Johnny Cash always did his own thing. He never followed anyone. He never answered to anyone.
Although the outlaw movement would prove to be an injection of excitement and rejuvenation for country, it would also lead to lifestyle choices that bordered on self-destruction. One of country's biggest players in the outlaw movement, Johnny's good friend Waylon Jennings, was only one of several that experimented with drug use.
The things I've done in my life, you know, if you could change them, a lot of things you would. But as you're going through, you say, you know, if I could live that over, I wouldn't do that. Well, you probably, if you knew what you know now, but most of the things I got into because of either stupidity or I thought I was doing the right thing, you know. A lot of things were not the right thing.
Particularly the outlaw movement, these guys did more drugs, drank more booze, bagged more groupies than most rock stars
and
did.
And Motley Crue looked like Boy Scouts, you know what I mean?
Mike Ness of the punk band Social Distortion has covered Johnny Cash, and he has always drawn a comparison between the rebel spirit of the outlaw movement and punk.
I saw connections from that to punk music very early on, and I think a lot of bands did.
The outlaw thing started, and what killed that movement was them thinking of themselves as rock stars. I mean, in other words, they got into that lifestyle to the point there were a lot of drugs.
If the typical image of a rock star is one of wrecking hotel rooms and taking drugs, Johnny Cash was no exception. He first started taking amphetamines in 1959 to help him get through his schedule of nearly 300 shows a year. In fact, Johnny admitted an addiction to amphetamines and barbiturates throughout the 60s and 70s. By the early 80s, Johnny began suffering from ulcers, which led to morphine addiction. He would be admitted to the Betty Ford Clinic in 1983.
The addiction and so forth. I can't deny that. I don't like to talk about it, but I can't close the door on it and turn my back on it because, like I say, there'll come a time when I'll be compulsive and impulsive. And that's why I say daily, by the grace of God. You know, that beast is caged. He is right now, anyway.
Don't turn on us.
By the end of the 80s, Johnny Cash would be clean. He would credit his strong faith in Christianity for shaking his addictions.
Because the prophets wrote about it and Jesus spoke about it and John got to take a look. And he told us what he saw and it's easy to see. It's going by the book.
And God is the answer. It's just the answer. And he says, ask and ye shall receive, seek and ye shall find. And that's what we have to do. And so we do that daily.
By the early 90s, country radio had latched onto new country, a catchphrase describing the proliferation of younger country stars using pop sensibilities. The older artists, despite being major influences on the new stars, would get shut out of country radio programmers' lists. But Johnny started showing up on other stars' albums, proving that his legendary status could not be denied.
Been 10 long years since the devil laid his fiddle at Johnny's feet, and it burned inside his mind the way he suffered that defeat. In the darkest pits of hell, the devil hatched an evil plan to tempt the fiddle player, for he's just a mortal man.
What would it mean to someone like Bono to work with Cash?
I think to Bono it means something along the lines of authenticity. Johnny Cash is the real deal. He's been everywhere. He has a song, I've Been Everywhere, and it's true. As we discussed, he crossed many lines and he did everything super well. Once you have that boldness and that integrity, that's what you get when you have Johnny on one of your records.
Yeah, he's a giant of a man in many ways.
Before Daniel Lanois's producing success for U2, Peter Gabriel, and others, he would work with Cash for a Canadian Bank TV commercial promoting the now-defunct Johnny Cash machine.
He came up to my studio in Hamilton. I think he was just doing like a commercial or something, but nonetheless, it was great to see him, Johnny.
Their Johnny Cash money machines are open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That's right,
all day, every day, just for you.
I think people think Johnny's cool because he always stuck to his thing.
He's just cool. He's like the definition of rock and roll, I think.
The epitome of cool. He's the coolest guy around.
I keep the ends out for the tie that binds, because you're mine, I walk the line.
What does cool mean? It's such a huge word.
I don't know. It's your word. I don't know. Cool.
You've heard it a lot this year, though.
Oh, yeah, I've heard it a lot this year, and I'm complimented, and I appreciate it.
One of many that thought Cash was cool was renowned hip-hop metal producer Rick Rubin. When it seemed the major labels had no interest in the icon, Rick Rubin signed Cash to his American Recordings label. His debut with Rick Rubin would be a stripped-down effort, featuring only Johnny's voice and his guitar. Rick basically pressed the record button and got out of the way.
Drive on. It don't mean nothing. My children love me, but they don't understand.
And here I could finally do an album that I really felt from the heart and the gut, you know, that that this guy can see the beauty of simplicity. You know.
You've called this your dream album, in fact.
That's what I'm talking about.
And I'd be dead, but by God's grace, drive on. It don't mean nothing. My children love me, but they don't understand.
Painfully honest. Because you hear it all. You hear all my flats and sharps and my bad notes and everything. It's very primitive.
Then at some point, his tear ducts all ran dry. Grew to be a man. It all hit the fan.
You're considered an alternative music icon now.
I think the new generation are, they recognize honesty right up front. You know, they're used to hearing a line of dialogue all day long from the television, the radio, and they recognize truth and honesty. And I think they appreciate that. The young generation who are so bombarded and lambasted with so much dialogue all day long, they can pick out the real thing from the rest.
There's an entirely new audience that's being introduced to Johnny Cash now. And that's what happens when you stick it out. And the reason that he sticks it out, I think, is because he doesn't play music for money, and he doesn't play music to be on the charts. He plays music because he can't help it.
Not once did a tear stain his face.
The two dogs on the cover, there has to be some sort of significance there.
I was in a wheat field in Australia, out near Melbourne, just out of Melbourne, shooting these pictures, and these two dogs come running from across the field at a farmhouse, past the train station, over the railroad tracks, and started playing around at my feet. At some point, they settled down, and the photographer kept on shooting. I named those dogs Sin and Redemption, kind of the theme of the album, you know. And the dogs are black and white and white and black, neither quite all the way. That's kind of like me.
American Recording's first single, Delia's Gone, was classic Cash storytelling, a haunting song about the murder of a young woman. Although not graphic, the video was banned by various video channels due to its subject matter.
Delia's gone, one more round, Delia's gone.
There's a big deal made over it. But Delia's Gone is part of the American culture folk fabric. Murder songs and songs of tragedy. It's a folk song from the 20s or 30s that I added verses to and rewrote it to make it a whole story. But this song is rooted in the deepest foundation. There's not a happy ending to a lot of stories in real life, and that's what this is. It's a slice of life. It's, like I say, a reflection of the culture of the people and the minds of the people. It's not nearly as violent as the network news. You know that. But I'm an entertainer. I'm a teller of tales, and some of them are pretty dark tales. Because that's the way life is.
Cash would go on to record four albums with Rick Rubin. 96's Unchained and 2000's Solitary Man would feature Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers as his backing band.
Rick Rubin, who's an incredible producer of, you know, some of the greatest alternative records that came out in the last 10, 15 years.
But metal and rap, and I think it surprised people that all of a sudden there he is working with Cash.
Well, I don't know if it's that much of a surprise because it sort of comes from the same place. Metal touches on, you know, sort of the dark side, you know, the lower frequencies. Johnny did the same thing. I think that's what Rick Rubin recognized.
Johnny's four American Recordings discs not only rejuvenated his career, but also acted as a celebration of the icon's almost 50 years of recording. An eclectic mix of guests would take part in the recordings. Both family and friends like June Carter, Merle Haggard, and Marty Stewart lent a hand, and Sheryl Crow, Don Henley, Nick Cave, Fiona Apple, members of Fleetwood Mac, and the Red Hot Chili Peppers all eagerly participated. The always open-minded Cash was writing new material, reworking his own classics, and covering songs by a wide mix of artists like Glenn Danzig, Leonard Cohen, Tom Waits, Beck, Tom Petty, U2, and even Soundgarden.
I'm gonna break my rusty cage and run. I'm gonna break.
Are you a big fan of Johnny Cash's?
Ever since I was a little kid, yeah.
Do you like this version?
Yeah, it's pretty wild. I mean, it just sounds like he wrote the song. And I think that's kind of what you're supposed to do. Like, when we've always done covers, we always try to take a song that wouldn't be something we would normally do, like when we did Girl You Want by Devo or something, and then make it sound like we wrote it. That's what he did.
What have I become? My sweetest friend. Everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all. My empire of dirt.
Coming up on the story of Johnny Cash, despite several health problems and internal demons, Cash continued to press on.
That beast is in the cage now, inside of me. He's caged up. But like the song says, they're frail and fragile bars. And every morning when I wake up, he's in there howling.
I hurt myself today.
2002 would be a celebratory year for Cash and his legacy. To commemorate his 70th birthday, Sony Music would reissue over a dozen classic albums from the Cash catalog featuring various bonus tracks. The reissue treatment continues in 2003 with more titles planned for re-release. And in late 2002, Cash would release his fourth endeavor with Rick Rubin, The Man Comes Around. The disc would end up on many critics' lists as one of the year's best releases. The recording features his own material, as well as covers from The Beatles, Depeche Mode, and Nine Inch Nails.
My empire of dirt, I will let you down. I will make you hurt.
2002 would also see two tribute albums to Cash. Johnny's ex-bandmate, ex-son-in-law, and good friend Marty Stewart spearheaded the 14-track Kindred Spirits, an amazing collection of songs that features Sheryl Crow, Bob Dylan, Emmylou Harris, Bruce Springsteen, Steve Earle, and others.
The absolute standard of the record was for me to be able to go at the end of it and sit in front of Johnny Cash and hand it to him and sit there and look him straight in the eye and play it and go, we honored your songs the best we could. It's hard making a record on songs like this. First of all, when they were done right the first time by such a stylized artist and such, you know, a guy with such a, you know, incredible persona, you know, and such a unique voice. I mean, you know, it's just hard to better the Mona Lisa. I Walk the Line was done right the first time. Hey Porter was certainly done right the first time. On and on and on and on. But I do think that the people that showed up to do it, you know, bring an incredible persona to their, you know, to their music as well. So it took some powerful personalities to pull his songs off.
I think he is part of the definition of rock and roll in that he has always kind of had an original voice. He's always been outspoken. He's stood up for the things he believed in. He's been a bit radical. He's been an anarchist. And he's been a spiritual man. He's been a man who's always been searching. His music, I think, will be remembered as the fabric of the American way of life.
Johnny Cash is timeless. He's the man. He's probably, you know, the most important guy that ever walked through the gates of Music City.
Despite persistent health problems over the years, Johnny continued to press on. He suffers from diabetes. In 1988, he underwent bypass heart surgery. He would suffer several bouts of pneumonia in the late 90s, ruining his lungs and keeping him from walking for 6 months. In October 2001, he was in a coma for 8 days. Glaucoma has stolen most of his eyesight.
Everyone I know goes away in the end.
He never quits creating. The microphone loves him. He loves the microphone. Where there's a pen and paper and a guitar, you know, I know that he's going to be up to something.
Part of his nature is seeking out that passion.
and following it to its end.
Despite finding peace in his latter years and kicking his self-destructive bad habits, Cash admitted in his 1994 interview he continues to wrestle with internal demons.
You know, there's that black dog and that white dog still in there fighting every morning. That beast is in the cage now inside of me. He's caged up. But like the song says, they're frail and fragile bars.
The beast in me is caged by frail and fragile bars.
They're frail and fragile bars. And every morning when I wake up, he's in there howling, wanting out. And I have to pray, you know, and dedicate that day to God. And the beast lays low, but he's always ready.
The songs have that sense. They're very honest and they're very, very real, and they affect you that way. And they're timeless for the same reason that Woody Guthrie songs are. So, I mean, long after Johnny's, you know, gone, may he live 500 years, people will still be singing his song for that reason.
The boldness, the integrity, and the honesty, and the cool of Johnny Cash will live on forever.
His music and his legend will live forever.
You stay the hell away from me, you hear?
I wear this crown of thorns upon my liar's chair, full of broken thoughts I cannot repair. Beneath the stains of time, the feelings disappear. You are someone else. I am still right here. What have I become? My sweetest friend. Everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all. My empire of dirt. I will let you down. I will make you hurt. If I could start again, a million miles away, I would keep myself. I would find a way.
Ain't we a great team?
We better be.